Good evening. You're welcome in the 112th episode of Zoology classes organized by Society of Carrier Technology and Jan Vikas Mahasabha. So, what is respiration? Respiration is a combustion or slow burning. It is oxidation of food material to liberate energy. But the problem is that in our body, it has to take place at normal temperature. So it takes place by the help of many enzymes, and slowly energy comes out. So respiration is oxidation of food material to liberate energy. C6H12O6 plus 6O2 gives rise to 6CO2 plus 6H2O plus 686 kilocalorie energy per gram mole. There are two types of respiration. One, anaerobic respiration, which may take place in absence of oxygen, and second, aerobic respiration, which takes place in presence of oxygen. Now, from surrounding environment, either from air or from water, oxygen comes in and it oxidizes the food material in the mitochondria. CO2 comes out, that CO2 goes out. If an organism is smaller than 0.5 millimeter, then by simple diffusion, oxygen can come in and carbon dioxide can go out. But if it is larger than 0.5 millimeter, then the internal cells are not in direct contact of the external environment. So, we should have a system conveyed to every body cell. For that, what happens? A breathing organ or respiratory organ develops, gill or lung, and from it, oxygen from surrounding atmosphere comes in, and then it is taken by the blood. Blood carries it to all body cells. In all body cells, oxidation of food material takes place, CO2 is formed. That CO2 is brought by these blood vessels from all body cells to this breathing organ. And from this breathing organ, then CO2 goes out. So, there are two steps. One, the external respiration or breathing, and which is simply intake of oxygen called inspiration, and exit of carbon dioxide called expiration. But rest of the reactions are included in internal respiration. You might have seen a fish cultured in an aquarium. Every time what happens? Its lower jaw is vibrating. And water is brought in the buccal cavity, and then through gills it passes out. In frog also, the same method is adopted. By the movement of lower jaw downwards, a negative pressure is created in the pharynx. Oxygen from surrounding atmosphere is brought in. Then the lower jaw is lifted upward. That oxygen is pushed to the lungs. You must have used your system at the birthday of your kids in ballooning. Just after ballooning 10-20 balloons, your cheeks are tired. But suppose we have a system like the fish or a frog. Every time, what will happen? Our cheeks and lower jaw will be fatigued. Earlier, there was no neck, no trachea, so the system was workable. But in higher animals, a neck and a trachea developed, and the distance between lungs and pharynx was increased. A very simple experiment is taught in lower classes. You can do it. a bell jar is taken, a tube is inserted in it, and it has a T or Y. Then on the both ends a balloon is tied. The lower portion, which is open, a rubber sheet is tied and a thread is connected. If the thread is pulled downwards, then air from surrounding atmosphere is brought in and it expands the balloon. Here oxygen comes in from surrounding atmosphere due to the negative pressure created in this. And the same thing takes place in our body also. The thoracic case is pushed forward and upward. The abdominal muscles are also pulled outward. And there is a muscle present in between thorax and abdomen, which is called a bell-shaped muscle, which is called diaphragm. Diaphragm is also pulled downwards. The volume of thoracic cavity is increased. Attached with the ribs or thoracic cage, two types of muscles are there. One, external intercostal muscles, which attach at the outer surface of the rib. And second, internal intercostal muscle, which attach on the inner surface of ribs. Contraction of external intercostal muscles elevate ribs outward and forward. So as a result of movement of all these three sets of muscles, the thoracic volume is increased. Oxygen is brought in from our nares into the nasal chamber, then into the trachea, and then into the lungs. So this way breathing or external respiration takes place. For controlling this breathing process, the part of brain which is located in pons and medulla oblongata is called respiratory center. This respiratory center has four components. One, the inspiratory center. Second, expiratory center. And two more centers are there. One, apneustic center, and second, pneumotactic center. All these centers are sensitive to partial pressure of CO2. So whenever in blood the concentration of carbon dioxide is increased, it stimulates first of all the apneustic center. Apneustic center then sends the message to inspiratory center. Inspiratory center causes inspiration. Thoracic muscles move. Oxygen from surrounding atmosphere is brought in. With this inspiration, there is a stretch in our muscles, and there are certain stretch receptors. These stretch receptors are affected. They perform two functions. At one end, these stretch receptors stop inspiration, and second, they carry the message to pneumotactic center. Pneumotactic center then sends the message to expiratory center, and expiratory center causes expiration. So this is the breathing process. Related with breathing process, there are some terms, and sometimes in different competitions some questions are asked on this. So let us see. In a normal quiet breathing, when we are just at ease and breathing takes place about 12 times per minute. So in a normal quiet breathing, the volume of air which is taken in and the volume which is sent outside, that is called tidal volume. And tidal volume is about 500 ml. Then, after a normal breath, suppose we have to take a strong breath. So some more amount of water enters, air enters. That is inspiratory reserve volume. It is about 3100 ml. Similarly, after a normal expiration, if we try to remove some more oxygen from our lungs, some more CO2 from our lungs, and there is a forcible expiration, then the amount of maximum amount of air which can be sent outside, it is called expiratory reserve volume, and it is about 1200 ml. After that, after a maximum deep expiration, some air is left in the lungs, which is called residual volume. So these are certain terms: tidal volume, amount of air which normally passes into and out of lungs during each breath, it is about 500 ml. Inspiratory reserve volume, it is the extra volume of air which can be inhaled in deepest possible inspiration, it is 3100 ml. Expiratory reserve volume, the amount of air we can expire over the tidal volume by most forcible expiration, it is about 1200 ml. Residual volume is the air volume which remains in the lungs after most forceful expiration, it's called residual volume, it is about 1200 ml. Then there are certain respiratory volumes. The addition of this inspiratory reserve volume and tidal volume, it is called inspiratory capacity. So it is about 3600 ml. The total amount which can be inhaled in a forcible inspiration and which can be expired in a forcible expiration, the total is vital capacity 4800 ml. Even then, some air is left inside the trachea, bronchi, bronchioles, which cannot be circulated, they just remain hidden in that space, which is called the dead space. It is also about 1200 ml. So this was about breathing. Now the second question arises, that how from the lungs or gills oxygen is carried to all body cells, and how CO2 is brought from body cells to the lungs. That is another part, transport of O2 and CO2, which we will discuss on the next turn. Thank you very much.